Hello everyone, and welcome to this presentation on our work, An Empirical Study of Real-World WebAssembly Binaries, by Daniel Lehmann, Michael Pradl, and me, Aaron Hilbig. All of us are from the University of Stuttgart. Let's first see an overview of what we've done. So basically, we collected a lot of WebAssembly binaries from different sources, like open source repositories, the web, package managers, etc. We find more than 8,400 unique binaries, which we make publicly available. And we analyze our data set and generate different insights regarding security, source languages, use cases, and more. WebAssembly was standardized in 2019. It's a low-level bytecode that was originally intended as a high-performance complement to JavaScript, but by now is also available on the server side via Node.js or in standalone VMs. And it's already available on more than 90% of browsers. On the bottom here, you can see a small example. On the left side, some C code. In the center, the WebAssembly text representation. And on the right side, the binary WebAssembly format. And as you can see from the text representation, it's very similar to other assembly languages and very simple. So why would anyone want to collect so many WebAssembly binaries? There are basically two main motivating factors. First, the uses of WebAssembly are not yet thoroughly examined. There exists some previous work, but I'll talk about that on the next slide. And second, no large dataset of WebAssembly binaries is currently available. So here are just some research questions that we want to address. What are common source languages that WebAssembly is compiled from? What are some security relevant properties of these binaries? What are the use cases of these binaries? Are they still mainly used just for crypto mining, or are there different use cases? And also, how common are minified WebAssembly binaries? This last point I will not cover in this presentation. Previous work only considers small test or evaluation sets for their studies. The study that's most important to us today is the study on binary security by Lehmann et al. From last year. We repeat some of their analysis on our larger data set. Then there's also performance analysis, and there's the binary instrumentation tool Wasabi. And as I said, all of these could benefit from larger evaluation sets. The study that's maybe closest to ours is the one by Musch et al. On WebAssembly usage and prevalence. However, they only considered one source, the web, and thus also only have a small set compared to ours. Ours is over 50 times larger. And we argue that language usage has progressed since. So in this slide, you can see some of the sources that we considered. First of all, we searched on GitHub for repositories related to WebAssembly and looked through over 3,000 repositories to search for binaries. We also looked on package managers like npm and weapon.io, which is a WebAssembly package manager for binaries. We did some web crawling. Actually, we did two approaches here. On one side, we queried HTTP Archive, which is a web archiving service and crawls more than 5 million URLs monthly. And we queried that for WebAssembly binaries. But we also did our own crawling and specifically looked for binaries with different detection methods. And there we crawled the top 1 million URLs and also lists of websites which we thought were related to WebAssembly. We looked at the top 2,500 browser add-ons for Firefox for binaries. And we also did some manual search, and there are also some other sources that are not included here. Now, from all these sources, we collect over 50,000 WebAssembly binaries, although there are some duplicates. So we use simple checksum to get the unique binaries, 23,000 of them to be exact. But in the set of 23,000 binaries, there are still a lot of binaries that are not really interesting for our data set. As you see now, for example, there are a lot of generated binaries, especially from all the open source GitHub repositories. There are many binaries used for fuzz testing WebAssembly parsers. So we filter these out. Also, there are test suites of binaries, for example, to test the WebAssembly specification, that we also filter out. We also found some WebAssembly tutorial projects that are probably all forked from like the same source repository, and they're not really interesting to us. So we also filter them out simply by the files of that the repositories contains or the file names. And finally, we filter small binaries with less than 10 instructions or binaries that are invalid and cannot be parsed by our parsers. And in the end, that leaves us with a data set of 8,400 filtered and unique binaries. So now let's take a look at some results. First of all, here you can see a size distribution of our data set. The median binary is about 37 kilobytes large. And as you can see, there are also some very large binaries, for example, TIDB, which is a database compiled to WebAssembly, OpenCascade.js, which is a CAD software compiled to WebAssembly, and there's also the full Clang compiler also as a binary. And these programs have up to 22 million instructions. So the insight here is complex real-world applications with millions of instructions are already compiled to WebAssembly. Next, let's look at the source languages. So it's non-trivial to determine the source language of a binary. Some binaries include a producer section where the compiler puts a signature, as you can see here in this example. And with those binaries, it's fairly simple to determine the language because, of course, if it says Rust C here, that's probably the Rust compiler and thus the source is probably Rust. But for all binaries that do not contain this, it's a bit more difficult, and then resort to some heuristics, for example, characteristic function names. As you can see here, this is just a mangled name of the C++ delete operators, so we would assume that this binary is compiled from C++. On the left here, you have the results, and you can see over 3/4 of binaries are compiled from either C++, Rust, or C. And by the way, this category here means we know it's either C or C++, but we don't know which one. And but there's also some other languages present. So the insights here are, as I said, over 3/4 are compiled from memory unsafe languages, which could lead to some potential vulnerabilities, as shown by previous work. But we get to the security aspects in a second. But we also find a variety of other languages with more complex memory models, for example, Go, MATLAB, and I think we even found a binary compiled from COBOL. So, as I mentioned, we look at security relevant properties of binaries. First, we look at how many binaries make use of the unmanaged stack, which has to be shown to be a source of vulnerabilities by Lehmann et al. Then we look at the memory allocators used by binaries. Do they make use of unsafe memory allocators? And third, we check whether WebAssembly binaries access potentially dangerous APIs, for example, whether they import eval from JavaScript. I won't cover this last part here, but I will briefly talk about the first two. So on the left here, you can see the share of binaries that make use of the unmanaged stack. To determine this, we again used heuristics by looking at what variables could potentially be used as a stack pointer. And as you can see, 2/3 of binaries use the unmanaged stack. On the right here, you can see the allocators used by binaries. We again used heuristics similar to the source language heuristics, so like strings in the binary or in the data section of the binary, to determine this. In blue, you can see the default allocators of the language runtimes. In gray, either we don't know the allocator or the binary doesn't actually use memory at all. And in red here, these are custom allocators that could potentially be vulnerable. And actually, emalloc and realloc here have been shown by previous work to be vulnerable to heap metadata corruption. So the main insights here are 2/3 of binaries use the unmanaged stack. Many binaries also make use of custom allocators in order to reduce binary size, which may increase the risk for vulnerabilities. And this raises the questions, should the memory maybe be managed by the host environment, so by WebAssembly, instead of the binaries themselves? So for the last bit of this presentation, I want to talk about the use cases for WebAssembly, first of all, crypto mining. And for the next two slides, we actually only consider the web subset of our dataset, so only the binaries that were collected on the web. So we used VirusTotal and also manual inspection of binaries to check for crypto miners and other suspicious binaries. And also Musch et al. Very kindly provided their dataset, so we could look at the intersection of our two datasets, which are actually only about 20 binaries, and we manually inspected all of those. And the previous study by Musch et al., they find more than 55% of websites using WebAssembly for cryptojacking. We, in contrast, only find 4 binaries from this web set to be suspicious. So the insights here are, it seems WebAssembly-based crypto miners significantly dropped in popularity, and this kind of motivates a shift in focus for WebAssembly security research too, because we shift from looking at malicious WebAssembly instead to vulnerabilities in WebAssembly programs. One may ask now, if WebAssembly is no longer used for crypto mining, what is it used for instead? And to answer that, we also looked at the use cases on one side, on the use cases of the most common binaries that we found a lot of times, but also we looked at a random sample of 100 binaries. But let's start on the left here. This is a diagram of unique WebAssembly binaries ordered by the number of occurrences on different domains or websites. So for example, the zeroth binary here occurred on about 350 different domains. And we looked at all these binaries and classified them. And the orange binaries here, they are simple tests for WebAssembly support. So they're very small and only test if the browser can, in theory, execute WebAssembly. Then the red binary here is part of long.js, which is a JavaScript library for big integer computation. And the green binaries here, they are also part of a JavaScript library, namely Hyphenopoly. And Hyphenopoly uses WebAssembly to speed up text hyphenation. Now, we also, as I already said, looked at this set of 100 randomly sampled binaries, visited all the websites, and tried to determine what they are used for. And you can see most prominent use cases are, for example, games, text processing, visualization. But in general, you can say they're used for lots of different stuff. So the insights here are WebAssembly application domains are very diverse, and it's already commonly used for computation-heavy tasks in various large JavaScript libraries. And what we think is exciting about these results, maybe, is that, for example, Hyphenopoly occurs on many simple websites, and we think that the owners of these websites maybe created the websites from some templates, and maybe they are aware that Hyphenopoly is used, but they're probably not aware that WebAssembly is used, and thereby people like the website hosts, but also the website visitors, already benefit from WebAssembly without really knowing this. And we think this is a good sign for WebAssembly's future. So that already brings me to the conclusion. We collect the largest available dataset of real-world WebAssembly binaries. You can see the link to our GitHub repository once again. And we collect this from a wide variety of sources, from the web, from open source repositories, from NPM, from browser extensions, etc. We find that many binaries are compiled from unsafe source languages, which may lead to security vulnerabilities. And we also find that much less crypto mining is done with WebAssembly. Instead, we find a diverse range of use cases which WebAssembly is used for. So if you have any questions, feel free to send us an email or attend our Q&A. Thank you very much for listening, and see you.